So over the next 20 minutes, I want to go over what are some of those celiac mimickers, and specifically those patients who have serologically negative enteropathies. So my hope is that after 20 minutes, you'll be able to detail the entities that can mimic celiac disease, identify the clinical and or histologic differences, and be able to distinguish between these differing disorders, and finally, outline an approach to the patient with serologically negative enteropathy. So I think we're all familiar with how to make a diagnosis of celiac disease. We like to see a patient who has clinical features that are supportive. They have serologies that are typically positive, small bowel biopsies that are characteristic, and then they have a clinical response to a gluten-free diet. But we certainly occasionally encounter patients that don't meet all of these criteria, but we really need to do whatever we can within our armamentarium to be as sure as we can about this diagnosis, because a lifelong gluten-free diet for a wrong diagnosis is really tough for the patient. So I'm not going to make pathologists out of all of you over the next 20 minutes, but I think it is helpful to first show some baseline normal histology, so then I think you can come to appreciate some of the very subtle differences you can see in the other forms of enteropathies. So this is normal small bowel, very long frond-like projections of the villi here, and you can still see that the villi to crypt ratio is in excess here of 4:1, very little inflammation in the lamina propria. And when you see a close-up here, again, like Dr. Pardee showed earlier with lymphocytic colitis, you can see very few lymphocytes here, these dark spots within the epithelial enterocyte cells, which are nicely lined up. And again, remember, goblet cells help us to define normal small bowel epithelium. So compare that with someone with celiac disease. And on the left, you see someone with very flattened villi, total villus atrophy, elongation of the crypts, and on the right side, you see an excess number of intraepithelial lymphocytes per epithelial cell here, and a very dense chronic inflammatory cell infiltrate in the lamina propria. So for this talk, I'm going to define and divide some of the mimickers as early mimickers, meaning those patients who you find that have intraepithelial lymphocytes, or IELs, but their villi are intact without atrophy, and then later we'll talk about those who have villus atrophy. So let's start with these folks with intraepithelial lymphocytes without atrophy. Well, I think it helps us to define what is normal, what's normal intraepithelial lymphocyte counts. So up until the year 2005, that number used to be greater than 40 IELs per 100 epithelial cells. And after that, the criteria changed that it's usually greater than or equal to 25 IELs per 100 cells. So why did this change occur? Well, some of those earlier criteria were based on jejunal biopsies, and we know that may not be indicative, obviously, of what we take, which is typically duodenal biopsies. Some of those earlier studies may have also been based on anti-CD3 staining, which may lead to higher lymphocyte counts. And so that is not recommended in practice because it may lead to overdiagnosis of patients with excess IELs when they really don't have an excess. So if you're like me, I had noticed over years that there had been a growing trend of seeing pathologic reads of the small bowel biopsies with increasing IELs but without villus atrophy. And so we looked at this at our institution a little more over more than a 10-year period of time. Patients with normal villus atrophy and isolated intraepithelial lymphocyte in adult patients. And what we found is over the 16,000 duodenal biopsies during that time frame, an average of 7% had that histologic finding. And if you look from the year 2000, where it only typically occurred in 3% of biopsies, you can see that in 2010, it was almost 11% of biopsies. And this was a significant trend, even when corrected for that change in definition that occurred in 2005. So you certainly are seeing it more commonly in practice, so it really behooves us to ask, why is that? You may think, well, maybe we're doing a better job of diagnosing celiac disease, which actually we found to not be the case in this study. If you look at the top black line, those are all of the patients who had basically non-celiac causes of these intraepithelial lymphocytes, which were really in excess of 70% of these cases over most time frames. You can see in red are the cases of patients with known celiac disease who had that histologic finding as they were coming back for follow-up EGDs. And the bottom line is blue are those patients with a new diagnosis of celiac disease. So if you exclude those patients with known celiac disease, only roughly about 7% of patients with this histologic finding had a new diagnosis of celiac disease, and other studies have reported ranges from 9 to 20% with that histologic finding and a new diagnosis of celiac disease. So if you look at the five studies that have been done to look at this histologic finding, and you can see they're all of varying size studies, again, like I mentioned, between 9 and 21% of patients had either new or known cases of celiac disease. So those were not all new diagnoses. Some were already known. You can see there's a smattering of other diagnoses made, tropical sprue, H. pylori, SIBO, as we just heard about. But I think it's worth noting that across the board, you can see it ranged from 8 to 21% of patients were on NSAIDs, which is likely grossly underreported because patients don't often tell us about this medication. It's also noted that up to 12% of patients may have had known or newly diagnosed inflammatory bowel disease. Now, other studies have been done which are very interesting in that patients with IBD typically have their intraepithelial lymphocytes that line the entire surface of the villi, whereas celiac patients tend to have a more tip-predominant intraepithelial lymphocytosis, which can be something that the pathologist may note. Also of note, up to a third of patients had no explanation for this histologic finding, and those are the patients that really perplex us to let us know what should we do with those patients, how should we manage them. So let's talk about the late histologic mimickers, those with either total or partial villus atrophy. So here was a study that was done, a 10-year period of time, again with patients that had that histologic finding. They were all adults who had villus atrophy in the duodenum, and they had negative celiac serology, so tissue transglutaminase antibody, deaminated gliadin peptide, and endomysial antibody. So all of these patients had a whole array of testing done to try to figure out what was the cause of that histologic finding, everything from HLA haplotyping, testing for bacterial overgrowth, autoimmune enterography or enteropathy, immunoglobulin levels, and careful medication review. So what did they find in this study? So if you can look here, 72 patients were included in this study, and in that first bar graph, these are patients they defined as serologically negative celiac disease. Now how they defined that, those were patients who had features that were compatible, they had negative serologies, they had permissive celiac genotyping, they had histology that was compatible, and that's why they were included in the study, and they had either clinical or histologic improvement on a gluten-free diet, and they exclude any of these other conditions. Now, some could argue those patients who had clinical improvement may have had gluten sensitivity, but nonetheless, that's how they define this in this study, and that was the most common thing they found. I think it's worth noting, though, that the second most common thing they found was medication-related villus atrophy. So again, a very careful medication review is warranted, and we'll talk about that more in a moment. And then you can see almost 15% of patients were considered unclassified sprue, meaning they couldn't find a cause to explain those histologic findings. Things like combined variable immunodeficiency, autoimmune, enteropathy, SIBO, Giardia were much less common. So it brings us back to the medication causes of sprue mimickers. So olmesartan is an angiotensin II receptor blocker. This was approved in 2002 in the United States for the treatment of hypertension. And in 2012, a report came out from Mayo Clinic on 22 patients that were referred to our institution for refractory celiac disease, all of whom had negative serologies. And looking back, all of them were on olmesartan for treatment of hypertension. So after this report came out in 2013, the FDA communicated that they had to change the label on olmesartan to include that it can cause intestinal problems, specifically a sprue-like enteropathy. So after the Mayo study came out, the French and a group in Spain also looked back at their patients who had this histologic finding who were also on olmesartan. And what they found was really some interesting findings. So you can see that the median age of patients was roughly 70 years. So these are older patients being treated for their hypertension. You can see that the mean time in two studies and median in the third was roughly 3 years that they had been on this medication before this diagnosis was made. So these are patients who are often, you know, on this drug for years, later become symptomatic, and they may be misdiagnosed for a number of years as well. The thing that I think was fascinating when comparing is that in the studies that did HLA testing, many of these patients actually had permissive celiac, one of the two permissive celiac gene pairs. So it may suggest in these patients who have permissive celiac genes may be more susceptible to this drug-related side effect. You can see that diarrhea was universal, as well as abdominal pain and weight loss. And you can see in the Mayo study something that was also fascinating is that a third of patients had significant collagen deposition in the small bowel, and two-thirds of patients had acute inflammation in the biopsy, again, which is typically not seen in celiac disease. So when you go back to this study that I mentioned, they went back and looked at their medication-related cases of villus atrophy, and of 19 of those, 16 of those patients were on olmesartan, and 11 of those 16 patients had significant collagen deposition in their small bowel biopsy. Two of the 19 were on mycophenolate mofetil, of which one had significant collagen deposition, and one was on methotrexate. So here's a histologic specimen of someone with olmesartan-induced enteropathy. So again, you can see that this looks like one of the worst cases of celiac disease. Mimickers, so complete villus atrophy. You can see this kind of denuding of the surface epithelium, which can be seen when there's collagen deposition. You can see lots of a combination of acute and chronic inflammatory cells. So what are some of the other medications that can mimic celiac disease besides olmesartan? Well, ipilimumab is a new monoclonal antibody used by oncologists to treat melanoma and prostate cancer, and this can mimic celiac disease in the cases reported. We've all probably seen patients with mycophenolate mofetil-induced diarrhea, and this can cause villus atrophy and a celiac-like enteropathy, as have been reported cases of colchicine, methotrexate, and azathioprine, with these results being reversible with drug discontinuation. So let's go back to collagenous sprue. Again, we've seen patients with this, and I think it really, now that we're seeing some of these medication effects, we may look at these patients a bit differently. So these are patients who have histologic features of celiac disease, but also have a thickened layer of type 1 collagen. And as I mentioned, sometimes when you have that collagen deposition, you tend to get detachment and damage to the surface epithelium. So I think it's really important when we see cases of collagenous sprue to do a very careful medication review, given we've seen a very high number of those patients in that one study that were on a medication that could mimic celiac disease. Because we don't know initially if that's what the cause is, medication or not, we may at least initially put those patients on a gluten-free diet just to make sure that we're improving them symptomatically, given these patients are quite ill initially. But patients who have collagenous sprue that's not related to a medication may frequently need immunosuppression, and some of the histologic findings may persist even with medical management. Well, what about combined variable or common variable immunodeficiency? Again, you could see in that study that this was a cause of some cases of serologically negative enteropathy, and we certainly have seen this not uncommonly in our celiac practice. So these are patients who, by definition, have to have immunoglobulin IgE or IgG level 2 standard deviations below normal and one other immunoglobulin level that's below the level of normal. I think we often think about this as a disease of young people and teenagers, but actually this can occur at any age. There's a gender equal between men and women. And I think we think, well, these patients will come to us with a very broad history of respiratory and GI infections, but oftentimes that's not the case, and some of those infections can be subtle. So again, this is something that we should always think about in those patients who have serologically negative enteropathy to check their immunoglobulin levels to make sure they don't have CVID. Again, your pathologist may give you some clues here to the diagnosis. So one of the things you may see in this entity is a reduced or absent number of plasma cells. So again, if you look at this histology, one thing that you may notice is there's just a relative paucity of cellularity in the lamina propria compared to the patient with celiac disease that I showed you. The thing that's challenging is upwards of 30% of patients with CVID may have normal levels of plasma cells, so their histology may look less apparent compared to this. But they may have more neutrophilia in their biopsy, lymphoid aggregates, some apoptosis, and you may be lucky to see some secondary infections like Giardia. But again, you may or may not see those things, and the biopsy may otherwise look quite identical to someone with celiac disease. So tropical sprue is something we have all been told about from med school on, and we're always told to ask about a careful travel history in someone who presents with features of celiac disease. Remember, this entity can look all the world clinically like celiac disease, and unfortunately, there's no specific test that we can do to make this diagnosis. These patients will have negative serologic markers, but this is a really important diagnosis to make because they don't need a lifelong gluten-free diet. They usually need vitamin replacements for their megaloblastic anemia, and they need antibiotic therapy. So a travel history is very important and often under-recognized. So this was a great case that one of our GI pathologists had emailed me on of tropical sprue, and he emailed me and said, here's a new case of tropical sprue. You couldn't make up a better story for it. In fact, it almost sounds made up. So I emailed back and said, let me guess, traveled to a tropical region and later got diarrhea. And his response is, no, lives in a tropical region and fell in a septic tank, then got diarrhea. So I can tell you the diagnosis is usually not this easy to make. We need to take a careful travel history. What about autoimmune enteropathy? We're seeing this with increased recognition in adult patients. Again, this is a disease most often seen in the 50s, and with equal male and female ratio. So again, all autoimmune diseases, we tend to think more common in women. This is not necessarily the case. This may or may not be in some patients linked to some of these mutations with regulatory T cells, as I've noted here. And these patients present with really significant diarrhea, malabsorption, and nutritional issues. So how do we make this diagnosis? These patients have chronic diarrhea and malabsorption, villus atrophy, but a few of the clues here is they have very deep crypt lymphocytosis and less predominant intraepithelial lymphocytosis. You may also be lucky to appreciate an absence of goblet or Paneth cells on a biopsy. You certainly need to exclude other causes of villus atrophy. And anti-enterocyte and anti-goblet cell antibodies can be supportive, realizing the sensitivity for these serologies are usually in the mid-80s and are nonspecific. So the picture on the left is a biopsy of someone with autoimmune enteropathy. And again, what you'll first notice is that the lymphocytosis in the crypts is very dark, very deep compared to the surface. And what you'll also notice when you compare across the patient with tropical sprue is there's an absence of goblet cells. So again, some of these things can be subtle, but when they're absent, that can really help hone in your diagnosis. And finally, how do we use T-cell receptor testing in patients who have a predominance of intraepithelial or lamina propria lymphocytes? So in the small bowel, you should have CD3 and CD8 cells in equal numbers, and you can see the biopsies here on the right, same cuts with staining for both of those. When you start to see a loss of CD8, that represents an abnormal clone. So the biopsies on the left are very extreme examples. I don't think any of us would mistake that for celiac disease, but I think on the right it demonstrates how the staining pattern can be helpful. And the top on this biopsy, very intense CD3 staining, but really a paucity of CD8 staining. So that can be helpful in these cases when you're trying to figure out if there's clonality in the biopsies. So again, we know how to make the diagnosis of celiac disease. We know what are the characteristic features. But when we start to see erosions, neutrophilic infiltrates, non-tip predominance of the intraepithelial lymphocytes, loss of things like goblet cells, plasma cells, and loss of CD8 expression, it really ought to give us pause, go back to that patient, and think about some of these other mimickers. So a proposed algorithm is that you first need to make sure in any of these patients that you have adequate small bowel histology. Once you have ruled them out for celiac disease with basic serologies, then you need to do a careful medication review, careful travel history, think about doing HLA haplotyping and checking immunoglobulin levels. Next, you could look at checking anti-enterocyte antibodies, Giardia antigen, HIV testing, which we did not talk about, breath testing or other testing for bacterial overgrowth, and in select cases, T-cell receptor staining. So in that patient with a serologically negative enteropathy who's ruled out for those other conditions, some would suggest that if they have permissive celiac gene pairs, start a gluten-free diet. If they do not have one of those permissive gene pairs, you might want to consider immunosuppression. So takeaway points, the most important thing in evaluating a patient with a serologically negative enteropathy are a careful history and a good pathologist. Next, isolated duodenal IELs is being seen with increased frequency. We know that NSAID use is common in these patients, but a third of these patients have unknown causes. Medications, both over-the-counter and prescription, may mimic celiac disease and should be considered in all patients with a serologically negative enteropathy. And finally, many mimickers of celiac disease have occluded the diagnosis and targeted therapy, and patients would much prefer a correct diagnosis over a lifetime of an unnecessary gluten-free diet. And I specifically want to thank Dr. Tom Smirk, one of our GI pathologists, who's graciously given me all of these histologic pictures. So thank you for your time and attention.